A PDF of artwork accompanies this program. Simon & Schuster Audio presents It Occurs to Me That I Am America, New Stories and Art. Edited by Jonathan Santlofer. With contributions by Julia Alvarez, Russell Banks, Bliss Broyard, Stephen L. Carter, Roz Chast, Lee Child, Susan Cryle, Michael Cunningham, Mark Diano, Anna Dunn, Louise Erdrich, Eric Fischel, Angela Flournoy, Elizabeth Frank, Neil Gaiman, Philip Gurevich, James Hanahan, Bridget Hawkins, Mary Higgins Clark, Alice Hoffman, Susan Isaacs, Gish Jen, Ha Jean, Deborah Cass, Jane Kent, Lily King, Sheila Kohler, Eleanor Lippman, Joyce Maynard, Beverly McKeever, Susan Minot, Marilyn Minter, Walter Mosley, Joyce Carol Oates, Eric Orner, Sarah Peretsky, Tom Piazza, Heidi Pittler, Mimi Pond, S.J. Roseanne, Richard Russo, Jonathan Santlofer, Shazia Sikander, John Quicktisee Smith, Art Spiegelman, David Story, Elizabeth Strout, Paul Theroux, Justin Torres, Alice Walker, and Edmund White. Read by Christian Barillas, Roger Casey, Amanda Carlin, Francois Chau, Robin Eller, Kyla Garcia, Arthur Morey, Jacques Roy, Parry Shen, and Candace Thaxton, with a foreword written and read by Jonathan Santlofer. An introduction written and read by Viet Thanh Nguyen. And a letter from Anthony D. Romero, Executive Director of the American Civil Liberties Union.
Forward. The idea for this book came together over a weekend not long after the 2016 presidential election. For weeks, I had been thinking, what can I do? Then I knew. I presented the idea to Touchstone's David Falk, who not only said yes, but helped form the book and has been its champion from day one. I knew something else. I wanted the book to give back, to not only be an incredible read and visually dazzling, but to put all of the creative work in the service of an organization that has been defending our civil liberties for almost 100 years, which is exactly what every writer and artist has done by donating his or her royalties to the ACLU. Having led a bifurcated life in art and writing, I also knew I wanted both visual artists and writers to share the stage. The idea of fiction surprised and scared a few writers until they thought it through and it became obvious. To write a story that dealt with some fundamental right or principle Americans take for granted that is currently threatened or under attack. From immigration to education, free speech and censorship, from women's rights to basic human rights, to the frustration, sadness, disappointment, and anxiety about losing the freedom Americans have fought for. The idea of America as an international symbol of hope, and the most basic notion of all, what it means to be American. The completed stories show the variety and diversity that is America now. From a depiction of a small-town life and the awakening of racism to a sophisticated party where racism and sexism form the backdrop for impending tragedy. Several authors delivered chilling stories that glimpse a not-too-distant future, where prisoners are jailed for crimes and transgressions he or she might never have committed. A dystopian world where knowledge, specifically admitting to possess knowledge that falls outside of one's assigned station in life, may prove deadly. And a Kafkaesque trial that has dispensed with civil liberties and truth. There are heartfelt pleas to pay attention, a bookstore that stands as a symbol of freedom and free speech, catastrophic floods, dying trees, disappearing species, unexamined lives, missed opportunities, a teenage pregnancy, and an illegal abortion. Academia's political correctness is skewered in one story, a prestigious art colony democratized in another. There is hate crime, the Holocaust, and reflections on war both at home and abroad, but there is also humor and laugh-out-loud satire. Some rewrite classics from a new and novel point of view. Others examine gender from inside out or offer an incisive glimpse of women, class, social conscience, and camaraderie in the 1950s and 60s as a mirror for today. There are autobiographical explorations, pieces that read as pure poetry, one as cool urban pop, another composed of rapid-fire dialogue that evokes the dissonance and disparity between people, the disbelief, wonder, and pain that is so much a part of this moment. The never-ending generational conflict forms the basis of one story. Understanding one's own familial racism is at the core of another. What it means to be an immigrant versus a refugee underlies a tale of expatriatism which plays perfectly against a detailed account of naturalization and what it meant to become American. Writers take on learning or not learning American values. Truth in a time of fake news, the making of a revolutionary, the East-West culture clash, racial controversy, anti-Semitism, a reflection on the legacy of evil, and post-election feelings of sadness, betrayal, and confusion. There is grief, and there is optimism. There is darkness, light, sadness, and wit. And there is art. Comics, cartoonists, graphic novelists, painters, photographers, printmakers. Sumptuously painted depictions of America's good life, who pays for it, and how it goes bad. A cartoonist's funny, earnest, often misguided personal history of politics. A redacted Declaration of Independence. Beautifully raw paintings that explore issues of race. Photographic images loaded with commentary about women, sexuality, and contemporary culture. Mixed media portrayals that examine myths, stereotypes, and the paradox of American Indian life. An irreverent and hilarious graphic alphabet detailing the ABCs of a certain Mr. Trump. Artwork that mixes cultural and political figures to tell visual stories in traditional yet unexpected ways. A cartoon bingo game of American rights. A pen and ink exploration of what it means to be mixed race. Drawings that depict the atrocities of torture. A satirical painting that unites the iconic log cabin with the contemporary skyscraper. Comics that employ iconic images of Ellis Island and the Statue of Liberty to drive home ideas about immigration and freedom. The artist's eclectic variety in medium and vision complement the wide range and multiplicity of the writer's words and themes. Some of the writers and artists in this collection I knew personally, others only from their work. But I feel as if I've come to know every one of them through their contribution and cooperation, their willingness to commit, to say yes, to create something meaningful. I'm proud and honored to have worked with this extraordinary group of people. This book belongs to them and to everyone who values our country's rights and privileges, who believes in decency, in a freedom that was fought for, and a democracy that may be imperfect, but one we cherish and need to preserve. This book represents more than a collection of great prose and beautiful pictures. It represents hope. Jonathan Santlofer, October 2017.
Introduction. I am a writer, and like all writers, I believe in the power of stories. My first love was literature, especially fiction. And so I was thrilled when I was invited to write a few words to introduce this anthology, which is about the power of fiction to shape and to state who we are. I have a daily reminder of fiction's enduring magic delivered to me by my son. He is 4 years old. Every morning and evening, I read to him. I love the joy he takes in learning new words, immersing himself in stories, seeing himself as the characters, and acquiring a moral and ethical sense. He lives in a fictional world of good and bad, of threat and rescue, of the choice between doing good and doing harm. When I was his age, I had just arrived in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. It was 1975. I was a refugee and the child of refugees who had fled Vietnam. My parents had neither the time nor the ability to read to me in English, so I took refuge in the local public library. It became my safe space and books my constant companions. I imagined myself amid the wonders of Manhattan, the bucolic splendor of Midwestern farms, the stirring and dreadful times of the American Revolution and Civil War. Even if there was no one who looked like me or had a name like mine, through these stories, I became an American. As I remembered this during our most recent presidential election, what became clear to me was that the contest for our American identity isn't strictly a political affair. It is also a matter of storytelling. Those who seek to lead our country must persuade the people through their ability to tell a story about who we are, where we have been, and where we are going. The struggle over the direction of our country is also a fight over whose words will win and whose images will ignite the collective imagination. Donald J. Trump won barely, and by the grace of the Electoral College, his voters responded to his call to make America great again, referring to a past when jobs were more plentiful, incomes more stable, and politicians more bold. That kind of nostalgia is powerful and visceral, but it's hard to ignore the subtext. America of the Golden Age, if it ever existed, kept women out of the workplace, segregated and exploited minorities, and restricted immigration by race. It's hardly surprising that the population of much of the literary...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.